You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show. We talk all about the new agent framework for next-gen multi-agent solutions. My friend Elijah, make sure you tune in. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI Show. We're talking all about the new agent framework for next-gen multi-agent solutions with my friend Elijah. Elijah, how you doing, my friend?
Seth, good to be with you, my man. I'm doing really well.
We did a thing at the last thing where we got to work on demos. So Elijah and I are we're what we call BFFs now. So tell everyone what you do at Microsoft.
Yeah, awesome. I'm a PM on the in the Azure AI Foundry team, specifically working on semantic kernel, AutoGen, and now the agent framework, which I'm super excited to be showing with you guys today. This is kind of a first look access to it. It's exciting stuff.
Ooh, I'm excited. So why don't we start first? What is it? Because I know there's a lot of options out there for doing agentic stuff. And there's a lot of options even from just Microsoft. Can you tell us about the agent framework and how we should start to think about this?
Would love to, Seth. So yeah, to get into it a little bit, we're living in an agentic world nowadays. I'm in San Francisco and you can't go 5 minutes without slamming your head into an agent billboard advertisement, etc. And as these and at Foundry, we're proud to have our own Azure AI Agent Foundry service. We worked on this heavily alongside Seth and some of our other colleagues to launch this back at Build in May. But now we've kind of gotten past just the need for a single agent and more into the realm of multi-agents. Single agents are really good for like very specific individual tasks. Whereas multi-agent systems can kind of accomplish a wide variety of tasks that require a diverse set of skills. If you think about a company, I'm really good at product management. We have great engineers on our team, great marketing folks, and everyone has their own individual skills. When we all come together as a team, that's when we're able to accomplish and ship cool products like the ones you're about to see today. And the same is true for multi-agent systems. An individual agent, like if you give it too much scope, it could get confused and whatnot. But when you have multiple agents working together, then you're able to accomplish these more interesting and complex tasks. Yeah.
Yeah, I absolutely love this slide. Is it okay if I steal it for other things? Because
100%. Like
the fact is that we started with no agent, right? But it's kind of an agent, but not really. Its agency is limited to like just here's your completion. The single agent with tools and et cetera is super good. But this multi-agent thing that you have here, there's so many options for how to string all of these string all of these things together, right? How do people decide what to do? And then what should they be doing once they've decided?
You know, that's a great question, Seth. And I'm going to talk about that here a little bit in a second, because I think there's a lot of different ways that you can fit multi-agent systems into the work that you're doing day to day. But I think the question that you posed so eloquently at the beginning is like, okay, but how do I even do this? How do I even get started with multi-agent systems? And that's where this awesome agent framework comes into play. So for a little bit of historical context, here at Microsoft, we had two different agent frameworks previously, AutoGen and Semantic Kernel. And for a little bit of history, AutoGen kind of came out of the Microsoft research side of the house. Semantic Kernel came out of the product side of the house. And it was kind of both had some great pros and cons to them. AutoGen was very lightweight. Semantic Kernel was really good for production workloads. But it was oftentimes confusing which one you should use and when. And so what we've tried to do is bring the best of both worlds together into this Microsoft agent framework that you see here today. So we're super excited to announce that and be rolling it out to public preview this week.
I see. So the agent framework then, if you could go back to the previous slide, is a combination of both AutoGen and Semantic Kernel together. Like it's like the good bits smushed together in like a sandwich.
Absolutely. I think that's a perfect way to describe it. We're trying to bring the lightweight prototyping nature of AutoGen, we're working really closely with some folks at Microsoft Research to bring the latest and greatest into Microsoft Agent Framework. But then we also know especially in the enterprise, you need that heavy duty production workhorse that is Semantic Kernel and all of the customization features, et cetera, that exist in there. And so, yeah, bringing the best of both worlds to be able to prototype quickly, but then also to be able to deploy to production.
Now, is this going to be available in like C# and Python for both languages?
Yes. So great question. Fully open source. We are 100% committed to open source. And on day one, it will be in Python and C# with hopefully other languages coming soon.
I love it. All right. What do we got next?
Awesome. So then to answer your question that you brought up earlier, Seth, is like, okay, but when do I use multi-agents and where do I fit this into my jobs day to day? And so we have kind of two different schools of thinking in it, where one is agent orchestration. And agent orchestration is, hey, I just want a bunch of purely non-deterministic agents to work together to accomplish some sort of task. And this can involve, as it says here, creative reasoning and decision-making, and leveraging those agents to accomplish a task like we were talking about earlier. However, what we're really excited for here with Agent Framework is this workflow orchestration. If you are familiar at all with Semantic Kernel Process Framework, I know we had a lot of fans of Semantic Kernel Process Framework, this allows you to bake into existing workflows, multi-agents into that process to be able to combine traditional business processes with also these multi-agent solutions. And for me, this is really exciting because it kind of gives you the best of both worlds, Seth, is that you're able to take whatever workflows that you already have in your job, and I'm going to show an example of that here in a second, and then plug in agents where agents are really good. Because as we know, LLMs are really good at coding, natural language, research, et cetera, but then they struggle in other things of maybe trying to string together too many data sources or whatever it may be. So that this allows you to really tailor your solution to leverage the agents where they kind of fit the best, and then also like not have to completely reinvent the wheel and reinvent your business workflow.
Let me see if this makes sense. I got to mute myself here. So what you're saying is that now I can look at a business process that I may have at work, and I can actually model it as a collection of agents in a process framework. I don't even know what to say. You said product in sort of a process framework that allows you to literally get a bunch of agents to do this kind of work. Am I getting this right?
Yes, absolutely. And it allows also the agents to interface with, hey, you know, maybe I don't want to use an LLM for a certain task. I just want to use good old NumPy or a Python package or a C# package. Then you can just use that for those things that regular coding that doesn't invoke all the token costs. You can use your business processes. And then when it's like, hey, I know I actually really need some more like thinking or a nice report written, then you can bring in the LLM to help you do that.
And I love this. I mean, you know me. We work together pretty closely, and I'm a fan of not using LLMs when they're not needed. And if you have already existing business processes like file a claim that you just need to call an endpoint to, just do that. But allow an LLM to take an unstructured text and, for example, put it into the form of a claim, which is a really, really good idea. This is cool. So do you have anything to show us that kind of does something like this?
Absolutely. Let's jump. And I know Seth is the king of demos and taught me everything I know about demos. So we're going to jump into some demos here.
Ooh, I love
and
it.
So what we're going to do here is this is a workflow that I've put together to help venture capitalists. As I mentioned earlier, I live in San Francisco. A lot of VCs floating around a lot. And so I thought, what's an existing event that exists in the VC space that I can help to automate and kind of bring in agents to an existing workflow? And so what we're going to be looking at here, and this was actually a SVG file that I was able to generate using our agent framework, is that it's a pitch deck parser. So basically, I'm going to take a pitch deck that a startup has sent me as a venture capitalist, and then be able to do a little bit of research, a little bit of analysis, and a little bit of hey, do I actually want to invest in this company? Yes and no, based on the suggestion of the AI. And this is going to involve, as you can see here, both traditional like processes of just like, hey, getting the research prepped and analyzing a slide deck. But then also I'm going to use some market and financial analyst agents, which you can see here in this sub workflow. And I'm going to run these at the same time to kind of get optimal performance there. If that makes sense. So here, I'm actually going to go ahead.
There you go. So effectively, you're basically modeling like how I would, like, what do I usually do when I look at like 1,000 pitch decks? I always go through this process. This is the process, but this diagram is drawn by the process framework after you've set it up, but you might also pre-draw one and then have the process framework and validate that the one that you drew by pencil works as well.
Absolutely. You can do this it either cool. way. And I think that's what's so cool about LLMs these days now too, is that you can really take images, give it to them, say, hey, turn this into code. This though is we have these great visualization features. We also have mermaid diagrams. I know a lot of people are big fans of mermaid diagrams.
Love mermaid.
The framework will automatically just generate those based on the steps that you have in your framework. So that's really cool.
Let's look at the code. Let's do it.
Let's do it. And I'm actually, Seth, going to go ahead and just kick it off here for folks. So here, you says, okay. This is the little UI I built. So while it's running in the background, I'm gonna go jump in the code. But so I'm gonna go ahead and upload this deck for Try AI. And so what it is, Try AI is kind of a Iron Man training company that uses AI to track your Strava and your Aura Ring and all your various to be able to give you kind of the best training plan for your Iron Man or whatever triathlon you got coming up.
And so this is going to go through that entire process.
Exactly. So while that's running in the background, I'm going to go ahead and show you guys like what exactly is happening step by step. So here we are, and this is really simple. What I did is I actually just I'm uploading a pitch deck file, and there's a Python a library that allows you to just pull out all of the information from a PowerPoint slide deck and turn it into JSON. And we know LLMs love JSON. And so it just super quickly, and then we're going to feed it to an LLM in the next step. So you can see extract all text content from a pitch deck, talks about, hey, it just verifies that there must be a PowerPoint file, does all that good stuff. And then it hands it over to our step two, which is our research prep agent.
So each of these steps then is modeled as a function inside of Python or inside of the process, inside of the agent framework.
Yes. So, and there's actually two ways to approach this. I did it in that there's kind of a simple way and a more complex way. The simple way is you can actually just model all of these as a function. If you want kind of more customization and more ability to have some control over it, you're also able to actually define classes and then classes to be able to determine each step in your kind of process.
I see. Okay, this is cool. How do you wire these together? Where's the thing that says start here and then call all these other things?
That's a great question. So I'll jump down to the end here so we can actually just see what that looks like in action. And this is very simple, very similar to like directed graph and a workflow process that people may be familiar with, where I'm just saying, hey, here's the start executor. And executor is basically our term for each individual node. And then, hey, I'm going to add this edge to go to the next step. Then I'm going to add an edge between this one to this one. And you can see I've got a whole bunch of edges here. And then I think what's also interesting that is, depending on whether or not I like this company, I have these conditional edges. So if something is triggered, in this case, it's like if I say, hey, yes, I want to invest in this company, it'll then route it to a specific part of the workflow. And if I say no, hey, I don't want to invest, it'll actually do a completely different behavior. So it gives the user a lot of great custom. You can see that here in the diagram as well. I'll zoom in a little bit. It's kind of zoomed out. Oh, I was a little too far. Where it's like, hey, I have this human approver. And then I'm able to then kind of say, hey, yes, and then it goes to the approved handler, or no, and it goes and it drafts me a rejection email to nicely let.
Can you show me can you show me the human approver bit? How does it shell back to the human in this case?
Yeah, so I'll go up and let's find that human in the loop step.
This is cool. By the way, if people are like, wow, there's a lot of code, I am okay with this, because the reality is that these functions are pointing to things like, here, I'll put our faces up as you find it. These functions could be ostensibly pointing to things that are already existing in your systems, right? This is code that you have already written to do certain parts of the job is what I'm in. So, all right. So what are we looking at here?
So yeah, great. That's exactly right, Seth. And great call out. So then we actually have this special class called approval request to be able to say, hey, do you approve this analysis, yes or no? And then there's also a routing decision that then takes like, hey, is this, in this my case, is very simple. It's just a simple yes, no. You could add some more complex logic here, but hey, it then sends this approval to the human and then asks me like, hey, do you approve the startup analysis, yes or no? And then it sends that message back to this kind of approval manager, and then that'll let it know which of the next routes it has to take. And if we actually want to see this in action, I'm going to go over back to here to our demo. So I have, so it gives me this little, hey, do you approve the startup analysis? This is the report that the LLM actually generated. So it's like, hey, this is scrolling away from me, but it keeps saying like, hey, this is some great stuff about, this is the overview.
Yeah.
If I scroll down, it's got some competitors, et cetera, recommendations for success. And then conclusion, it says, hey, it has the potential to redefine triathlon training, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So then based on that, I can be like, you know what, actually our fund is investing in fit tech right now. So I'm actually going to deny. Ooh, sad moment for our founders. But I'm going to say no. And then from there, the human decision, it'll run some logic and then hopefully give me a little look into the founders to let them know like, hey, maybe not right now, but maybe in the future. So
I have a sound effect for this. Hold on. Here we go. They do not get funding.
Denied.
This is cool.
And then it's actually nice because then I have a little rejection email. It's like, hey, dear founder's name, after careful consideration, we decided not to go with your thing right now, not to move forward. And then I can just copy and paste that into my email and send that over to the founders. So pretty cool stuff.
This is, dude, this is fantastic. By the way, I was looking at that graph stuff. I love computer science-y things. And so like I don't know what the right word is. I'm going to use this word. It looks delicious. I'm just going to say, right? Because it really puts into context, like, hey, you can make these agentic decisions coupled with decisions that you already have in your current processes. And you can even shell out to a user to make sure, hey, does this make sense? This is fantastic, dude. So where can people go to find out more?
So we have a open source repo on GitHub that I want everyone should go check out. Microsoft Agent Framework, it's what it's called. Blog posts, other developer content coming really soon. And we also have a Discord, a pretty active Discord that we'll link as well. So a lot of great places for people to go access more information about this and interact directly with the team. I think that's what the fun thing has been working on an open source project is that the team is very much involved with user feedback. And so if there's stuff that you like, don't like, please let us know in GitHub issues, on the Discord, et cetera. And that feedback will get really baked right into the agent framework.
You know what? And I am excited to get my fingers pruny in all of this goodness, because like this is the stuff I think that really is going to set like development shops apart from people that are not using agentic AI when you're able to do that. Because that thing you showed, I know it went really, really fast, but effectively you are literally automating a process of that takes forever. I got to open the pitch deck. I got to create a summary. But if there's a way to do that specifically when you're right, I think it's amazing. Thank you so much for being with us, my friend.
Of course. Thanks for having me, Seth. Pleasure being here.
And thank you so much for watching and learning all about the new agent framework for next gen multi-agent solutions with my friend Elijah. Thank you so much for watching, and hopefully we'll see you next time. Take care.